Hi everyone, my name is Theodore Mitev, and in this short lecture I will discuss the remaking or synthesis stage in developing digital artifacts. Now, the first thing to emphasize is that this stage is an inextricable part of the previous stage I discussed, that is the breaking stage or analysis stage. And it forms a continuous cycle of analysis and synthesis, which you undergo as you keep iterating through the media making process we've been discussing until now. Going through the two parts of this cycle, breaking and remaking, analysis and synthesis, is where you really discover the value of the fast, inexpensive, simple, tiny methodology and the fail early, fail often concept. This is because while the breaking stage involves analyzing the entire process so far by pulling the existing model of reality apart into constituent elements, the remaking stage, the synthesis stage, involves synthesizing a new model from the disparate elements identified in the breaking stage. And this is a continuous cycle of iteration, of destruction and creation. To retrace our steps a little bit and identify how these two stages, the breaking and remaking stage, link together, it's important to repeat that we always perceive reality and interact with reality. We make decisions about and act in the world based on models. And these are conceptual models, and these are practical models. These are ways of thinking about and doing things. And the thing is that models are fundamental. We cannot operate in the world without them. And this applies both on a very philosophical, abstract level, conceptual level, and also on a very practical level in the day-to-day reality of our existence. The thing is that these models never really correspond precisely one-to-one with the world, because the world changes continuously. It is not complex in the sense of some sort of linear complexity that can be analyzed with the appropriate tools. It is complicated in the sense of unpredictability. The world is complicated and always already above and beyond our ability to model it precisely. Hence, models never really fit reality precisely. They are never really perfect. They never really explicate the enormous complicatedness, richness, and variety of the world in which we operate. And when you think this through, you realize that this is a problem of perception, because our ability to model the world, to model reality in our minds, is basically what we term as perception. It's also a problem of decision making, because our ability to decide how to act in the world is entirely predicated on the correspondence of our models of reality with that world outside. And finally, obviously, it's a problem of action, because of the necessity for us to act in the world, right? To execute some sort of changes in that reality. And to make this even more complicated, every time we model the world and we make decisions about it and act in the world, we change the world continuously, right? So our ability to model the world has to continuously take into account all the multitude of ways in which we and everyone else around us is changing the world. Hence, we have a very complicated situation. This necessitates a continuous process, and we talked about this in the previous lecture, the lecture on analysis on breaking, a continuous process of examination of the world from a number of possible perspectives, as many perspectives as possible, in fact, so that, as military theorist John Boyd argued, we can generate mental images or impressions that correspond to that world. And the more different perspectives, the more different models of reality we deploy in order to examine the world, the better equipped we are with images or impressions corresponding to that world, right? Because the higher our chances that there will be some sort of overlap between our models of reality and the world at large. This is also why, and we sort of talked about this in the previous lecture on breaking, relying consistently on the same model of reality, consistently on the same way of thinking about, looking at, and doing things is a recipe for failure, because the world changes. And even if the formula that we deployed now used to work before, it might not necessarily work today, even if it worked yesterday, right? If we continuously rely on the same model, if you continuously deploy the same formula for doing things and thinking about things as you did in the past, this leads to a situation that we call inertia. What does inertia mean? Inertia means that you're continuously deploying the same way of doing things, the same formula of orientation, decision-making, and action. So no matter what changes in the surrounding reality, you are going through that same process, right? You are not changing anything. And this, over a period of time, leads to a situation where no matter what the changes outside are, and as we already established, reality changes continuously, so no matter how far your formula of doing things differs already from the surrounding reality, you are stuck in that one way of doing things. And this situation invariably, and I mean this in the most axiomatic way, so this is an axiom, invariably, if you find yourself in an inertia situation, this leads to a crisis, because there is invariably, again, tremendous disparity between the way you're doing things, the way you think about reality, the way you orient yourself in that reality and make decisions and act, and that reality. This leads usually to some sort of crisis, which usually ends up in some sort of catastrophic failure, collapse. When looking at large systems or large organizations, that is why it's so important to keep reevaluating one's model and to keep changing it. So to keep going through this process of analysis, breaking, and synthesis, remaking. And as we already discussed, when it is only when there is some sort of misalignment that you yourself have identified, so you've discovered that there is a misalignment, something is going wrong, something is not happening the way it should be. What does this usually mean when you notice that? It means that your model of reality, your formula for doing things with its predictive powers, right? It is misaligned with reality. It has not predicted that something would happen, hence it is a surprise. So when something like that happens, this is usually when you learn, when you discover that you need to break your model, you need to undergo an analysis and create a new model, right? So as this quote from Franklin Spinney so elegantly puts it, when things go out of whack, we can see something new and strange, and that is when we learn something. So in this context, things going out of whack can be something that happens without your interference, is simply reality interfering with your model, or it can be because you consciously decided to go through a process of analysis and to break down your existing model. In either way, the process of analysis involves breaking down the whole into parts, breaking down a model or a pattern of behavior or a formula for doing things that was internally coherent until now, breaking it down into constituent parts. This is what analysis involves. And this breaking down is not random. It's, as we already described in the previous lecture, it involves isolating individual elements that used to form that system. And this is followed by the second stage, which is the object of this lecture, the stage of remaking, the stage of synthesis, which involves building those disparate parts into a new coherent whole. And this is what synthesis is. So these two parts form a process. So pulling apart analysis is followed by, and should be always followed with a building a new synthesis. And this is a continuous process. It's a cycle that never stops. The moment you stop that cycle, you always end up with some sort of model, which is the result of some sort of synthesis. And then if you do not continue with analysis again of your own model, what happens invariably, again, as we mentioned, is inertia and crisis and collapse. So this is a looped process, it's cyclical, and it has to you have to continuously undergo this process when it comes to the way you see the world, the way you act in the world, the way you make decisions. And this, again, is valid at the macro level, at the, if you will, abstract conceptual level, but also equally valid at a very practical micro level when it comes to day-to-day decisions or some sort of organizational decisions and organizational perspective on reality. And the key thing here is that one part of this process follows the other, right? So you pull things apart as part of an analysis, and that's just the first half of the movement, because the second half of the movement is the immediate of, act of putting them back together in a new way, synthesis. And then this is followed again by a continuous analysis and synthesis. So in the previous lecture, we identified a certain a mindset which informs the analytical stage, the breaking stage. And the first rule of thumb here is that you have to presume your assumptions about how things are and should be are wrong. So you have to presume, and that's a presumption that is epistemological, so it should inform how you make your knowledge-based decisions and how you perceive reality. So you should presume that your assumptions are wrong. You should presume that they are at best approximations that will be, not maybe, but will be corrected by reality. This involves a process of creative destruction of one's own mental or physical structures. So analysis involves on the epistemological level, on the level of knowledge, a creative destruction of models of thinking. And on the practical, on the physical level, if you will, it involves the pulling apart of existing structures, existing ways of doing things, existing patterns of practices, and differentiating them into constituent components. And the final very important point is that breaking as a mindset involves a continuous analysis. It does not stop. This process of analyzing and pulling apart of perceived reality. And of course, after you've pulled apart all of these elements of perceived reality, you automatically are going into the second part of this process, which is putting things together in a new way, synthesis. So let's focus now on remaking, on synthesis. And as we established in the lecture on breaking, we use this example of the snowmobile, right? So in the process of, in the first stage, in the stage of analysis, we're starting with three different and fully internally coherent situations in reality. So we have a motorbike driving on the street, and we have water skiing behind a motorboat somewhere on sea, and we have a tank or some sort of all-terrain vehicle. And when you analyze those, you pull them apart into their constituent elements, right? So when it comes to the motorbike, we have all sorts of elements such as wheels and internal combustion engine and seats and rear view mirrors and handles. When it comes to the boat, we have outboard motor and the boat itself, the hull, the wheel maybe, and then we have the water ski on their own. And then we have the all-terrain vehicle or the tank with its tracks, again, its hull, etc., etc. So we have a bunch of different elements which are completely disparate from each other, right? So they do not belong to the same system, to the same model. In fact, they belong to three different isolated situations, right, which do not overlap. But what the process of synthesis does is it pulls elements from these heretofore coherent systems, which we've now analyzed and pulled apart, into a new whole which did not exist until then, right? Into a new creative, into a new object of a creative synthetic process. So we have, in effect, the handles and seat from the motorbike being used. We have the skis and outboard motor being used, and then we have the threads of the all-terrain vehicle being used in a creative way to create a new coherent whole. And that new coherent whole is jet skis. Now, key moment here is notice how the jet skis in and of, not the jet skis, the snowmobile. The snowmobile in and of itself does not fit with the previous models, the previous situations that were analyzed, right? So you do not have the snowmobile possibly appear as parts of those previous systems, as part of an all-terrain vehicle, was part of a water ski situation or part of a motorbike situation. It's a completely separate model of reality which is synthesized out of elements from these previous models. And this is in and of itself the basic process of creating through synthesis, creating a new model of reality. You have to pull elements from previous models relate them, adjust them in a coherent way which did not exist before. So it sounds very simple, but actually it's a very complex process. And at its base, like we already said, it involves putting things together in a new way. So I've described it here as an inductive process involving creative synthesis. So what does this mean? Inductive stands for putting something whole, a whole, creating a whole out of disparate parts. So you're starting from the parts and move towards the whole. So this is the opposite of the deductive process, which is starting from a whole and pulling it apart into constituent elements. So while in the analysis, in the breaking stage, you started with a whole, with an existing model, and you broke it apart into elements, in this stage, you are reversing this process. You're starting with the elements and you're moving towards a new coherent whole. So this is a process, right? It's, you have to undergo a certain amount of oscillations until you reach the end, right? It's not something that happens at once immediately. And it involves creative synthesis. So what does this mean? It means putting things together in new ways, right? This is a creative process because you more often than not make something completely new which did not exist until now. Why is that? Because you're putting disparate elements together which before did not belong to the same coherent whole, whatever that might be. This might be a way of thinking, or it might be a snowmobile, right? The principle is the same, right? It involves creative synthesis. So clearly there is a certain mindset being involved here, just like there was a certain mindset involved when it came to the breaking stage, the analytic stage. So when it comes to the synthesis stage, we can argue that there is also a mindset involved. And this mindset of remaking, mindset of continuous synthesis, first and foremost involves this, you could frame it as a attitude or as a way of thinking, which I've expressed as even if it's all the same, do it differently. So let's return back to the snowmobile example. You have all these different elements and that you've identified already. So you've divided the motorbike into internal combustion engine, wheels, handles, mirrors, and a seat. The temptation immediately is to reassemble these elements exactly the same way they were, right? So, which is in effect to recreate the previous formula, to recreate the previous model. And that's a temptation because that's the easiest thing to do, right? It's much easier to do things the way you were doing them before than to start thinking about how to position these old elements in a new way. But the key stage when it comes to entering the process of synthesis, of remaking, is to force yourself to do things differently, even if these are all the same elements you're looking at. The second stage, the second aspect here that I've expressed again as remaking as a mindset, is this notion of disparate elements. So what I'm suggesting is that disparate elements, when linked together, and by disparate I mean that normally or in the previous formula, in the previous model, they were not together, right? So you would, coming informed by that mindset that they were part of that previous model, you would again automatically be tempted to fit them together again in their old domains. So again, motorbike elements, all-terrain vehicle elements, separated by their domains because that's where they came from. So you'll be tempted to return them there. But the argument here is that these disparate elements often link together in unexpected ways, in interesting ways that you were not able to predict before. And when you adopt this as a mindset, it's much easier to go through that process of doing things differently, even if you're dealing with all the same elements, because you are in effect accepting that you can pick and choose, you can take bits and pieces from here and there, even if those elements were not previously related by the domains in which they operated, and fitting them together and seeing what happens. Right? So there is an element of risk here, an element of exploration, of going into the dark, as it were, because you do not know whether these elements would actually fit. But often they link together in unexpected ways, in interesting ways. And this is the beginning of a new synthesis. So when it comes to the mindset, there is a process of this kind of continuous trying to fit things, disparate elements together. Into a new way, into a new synthesis. And that's a continuous synthesis of the elements of perceived reality, right? So on a philosophical level, this is a continuous way of readjusting your model, first breaking it and then readjusting it from constituent elements. And on a practical level, this involves rethinking how you're using these elements in your project or in the way you're doing something. Whatever. So to reassess, we have this when it comes to remaking as a mindset, synthesizing as a mindset, we have first this dictum of even if it's all the same, do it differently. So you're constantly presumably pushing yourself to do things in a new way, to reassemble disparate elements in a new model. Then we have the presumption that different elements might end up linking together in unexpected and interesting ways. And finally, the admission that this is a continuous process, a process of continuous synthesis. So far, so good. Presumably, this all makes sense. But how does this work on a practical level? How does this work when it comes to the very process of synthesizing? So let's think about remaking as a process now. And the first step is to, again, reminder, you are starting here as you're starting the stage of synthesis as a follow-up from the stage of analysis, right? So some sort of model, some sort of reality, or some sort of object, domain, whatever you want to call it, has been analyzed, has been pulled apart into constituent elements. So this is the starting point. You have a bunch of constituent elements identified. And the first step here, armed with that mindset which we just identified, remaking is a mindset, the first step of the process of synthesizing a new whole, a new model, involves the effort to find commonality. So you should aim to find common qualities between these elements, common attributes. So again, you've, in the process of analysis, you've identified qualities, attributes, and operations. And in the process of synthesis, you're flawlessly moving into trying to find commonalities between these disparate qualities, attributes, operations among the elements that you've identified after analysis, right? So again, you've identified that, let's say, you know this part of that, of this domain, whatever that domain is, works in this way, and that part from that other domain works in that way, and then they have something in common. And this is a really important process, because once you identify enough of these commonalities, you start seeing ways of linking them together. So in our example, you have the handles and the seat, and then we have the body on tracks with an outboard motor, right? And then the skis somehow suggest themselves, and suddenly we have a snowmobile. And notice what's happening here. We have a bunch of commonalities being identified between these different elements. Needless to say, when it comes to these commonalities and their identification, the only way where you can see whether things really have something in common and can be linked is to test that. So there is a continuous process of testing while figuring out in the process of synthesis, right? So you're continuously trying to fit disparate elements together, bits and pieces, into a new whole. And while doing that, again, and I already mentioned this earlier, there is a constant temptation to return back to the previous model, to use the same elements with the same arrangements as you used to do it before, or as in the model that you disassembled, that you analyzed earlier. So the key part of this process, the second part, after you've started identifying the commonalities, is to resist the temptation to return back to the previous model. So avoid using the same elements and arrangements as in the model you just pulled apart. Why? Because if you keep using the same elements and arrangements, and again, there's a temptation to that, because this is the easiest thing to do. This is literally the most efficient thing to do, right? Because you do not bear any costs. Remember, if you are going to be spending X amount of time testing and figuring out how these different elements that you just analyzed fit together in new ways, there is a cost associated with that. There's a cost in terms of time, there is a cognitive cost in terms of figuring this out. There is a certain intensity to this process and a cost associated with that. The cheapest thing to do here is to keep doing what you were doing successfully before, which is to stick to the old model, which is to use the same elements and the same arrangements, the same old formula, right? So that's always already, and I want to emphasize this very strongly, always already the most efficient and cheapest thing to do is to stick to what you were doing before. But that is also always already the losing proposition. Why? Because with time, and I already mentioned this, I already explicated this earlier, with time you fall into what I described as inertia. And invariably this leads to a crisis because of dramatic misalignment between the model you're using and the external reality. And finally, collapse, because if something in the stage of inertia falls into a crisis, usually it's too late already to make any changes, and the entire model is pulled apart by reality itself. This is what collapses. So in order to avoid falling into an inertia, it's crucial to undergo this process of analysis and synthesis. And when it comes to the synthesis stage, avoid using the same elements and arrangements as in the model you just pulled apart. And another reason why there is always the temptation to use the same elements and arrangements is that looking at all of these other elements and arrangements that you've identified after your analysis, right, after the stage of breaking, pulling apart that system or model or domain or object or whatever, figuring out new ways to fit things involves fitting things that you presumed until now to be mutually exclusive or not to overlap in any way, not to have anything in common. And the reason you presumed that is because you were using that old model, right? Because each model of reality has its own assumptions about the way things are and should be, right? So in the process of synthesis, in the process of remaking, there is always that temptation to stay away from linking two disparate elements together because you presume that they cannot be linked. And the reason you presume that is because you still have deployed in your mind the old model. So another element of the process involves this awareness that new models or solutions will emerge from the combination of elements which until now you presumed to be incompatible, right? There is no way to know if they are incompatible without actually trying to link them together, without trying to testing whether they can work together in that new scenario you're building. Because remember, you've undergone a process of breaking. You've undergone a process of dismantling your model and finding literally finding yourself in a kind of indeterminate stage now, where there is no model that you're deploying. You're literally figuring out the new model on the go. And it's again always very tempting to keep deploying the presumptions of the old model, because again, this is a shortcut, it's cheaper, it's easier, it's more efficient, right? This is always already a losing proposition, as I already said, because the risk of inertia is always there. So you have to, in the process of remaking, you have to continuously presume that new models or solutions will emerge from the combination of elements presumed to be incompatible. That being said though, since you're creating a new model, you're synthesizing something from these disparate elements, right? Whether that's a new domain, a new model, a new object, that new model has to be internally consistent, right? So elements presumed to be incompatible might work together, but they might equally not work together, right? So all of this is figured out by testing, by being open to all sorts of different combinations which did not exist before, and by discarding combinations that clearly are not internally coherent, that do not work together. So this is a risky process. Again, this is a energy consuming process, time consuming process, but it's crucial because it leads to a new model of reality, to a new domain, to a new way of thinking, deciding and acting in the world. So the key moment when it comes to the sort of closure, if you will, of the process of synthesis is the creation of that internally and externally consistent model. So the pattern of ideas and interactions emerging with and from creative synthesis must be internally and externally consistent. What does this mean? It must be internally consistent because all the elements that you've now created again from all these disparate bits and pieces that were pulled apart at the end of the process of analysis at the end of the breaking process, they are fitting a new a new coherent something, right? So think of the snowmobile. We pulled apart all sorts of bits and pieces, and then we pulled them together in a new way, and we have a snowmobile. It is internally consistent, right? They stick together. They work together well, these elements. But what does externally consistent mean? And this is really important because you've created something which seems to make sense to you, right? As a model, as a way of doing things. And then you are testing it against reality. And if reality breaks it apart straight away, it means that it's not externally consistent. It's not consistent with the world out there, with that complicated reality as we described, right? So you have to start anew. Even if the thing, the object, the system, the model that you created seems to be internally consistent to you, right? These are your presumptions, however, they have not been tested by reality. So it's important that whatever you make as the end point of the process of synthesis should be both internally consistent, so it should make sense to you and should seem coherent, but it also should be externally consistent, so it should be able to operate with reality, right? You should be able to, if you imagine reality as a series of questions being asked of that model or of that plan or of that object, it should have answers to those questions. This is what external consistency means. So at the end of that process of remaking, at the end of that process of synthesis, you end up with something, with a new whole, with a new model, which is internally and externally consistent. So here we have remaking as a process in its entirety. You aim at finding commonalities among the qualities, attributes, or operations of the elements identified after analysis. You avoid using the same elements and arrangements as in the model you just pulled apart. New models or solutions will emerge from the combination of elements presumed to be incompatible. And the pattern of ideas and interactions emerging with creative synthesis, so this is the end point already of that process, must be internally and externally consistent. So this is something that you continuously test and observe in order to ensure that you have that consistency. So usually how this works in practice is that you deploy already that synthetic model, that new thing that you created out of disparate elements, you deploy it in reality, reality corrects it, so you very quickly go through a process of analysis and synthesis and you go through that process again. So this is again a cyclical element in that finishing stages of synthesis. And both the internal and the external consistency of that model that you've made, of that something, that new synthetic whole created as an endpoint of your remaking, are going to be continuously improved as well, right? So both the internal consistency in terms of how things stick together and what elements actually are involved, because you might end up changing this or that element or improving the way they link together, and the external consistency in terms of how the entire system that you've created relates to reality will also be continuously improved, and you will be doing it as a response to the questions asked by reality from your model, right? So again, remember, that new system that you've created is tested in reality. Reality asks all sorts of questions, and you have to make sure that it has answers to those questions in order to be externally consistent. So you see this in terms, again, of the snowmobile. You can probably trace back in history to how the first snowmobiles looked like, and they probably look very differently from how snowmobiles look today. The parts are probably not as good, so they're internally not so consistent as snowmobiles today. Externally also, they probably have much poorer performance than current snowmobiles because of that external consistency with reality. So this is a continuous iterative process here in terms of refining internal and external consistency when it comes to the systemic endpoint of that process of creative synthesis. Okay, so far so good. The final thing I wanted to point out to you is that this new model, this new system that you make as the endpoint of creative synthesis is not going to be perfect, right? So even if it is literally as good as it gets in terms of internal and external consistency, it will never fully fit with reality. It will never fully overlap with external complicated world, right? So it will always already fail to answer many of the questions asked from the external world. And that is something unavoidable. We already mentioned this several times. We started with this. No model is perfect when it comes to its correspondence to the real out there. And what this means is that the process doesn't stop. This means that the cycle of breaking and remaking continues unabated. So you've successfully deployed a new model. It's internally consistent. It's also externally consistent. It's working well in reality. You have success with it. But as you go along, you have to keep analyzing and pulling it apart, because chances are you will be able to figure out a better model, which corresponds better with that current situation in the real world. Because remember, the world is complicated. It's not complex. It's not moving according to some complex algorithm that can be figured out. It's completely chaotic. It constantly creates unpredictable situations which wreak havoc with all possible models, right? So modeling is always already at best an approximation, which has to be continuously corrected through a process of analysis and synthesis, right? So the cycle never stops. And this is crucial to remember, right? This is not a cycle that goes once and then you abandon it, because this is an automatic recipe for disaster, for falling into inertia and collapse. So as a takeaway from this lecture, the key point I want to drive across is that to maintain your capacity for decision-making and action in this complicated world, in an ever-changing world, you have to be constantly breaking and remaking your existing conceptual model. And I underline here conceptual, because whatever you're doing in terms of completely practical, completely trivial, even if you day-to-day activities, is always already rooted in some sort of conceptual model of reality. And it's at that conceptual level that you need to be constantly analyzing and synthesizing. You need to be constantly breaking and remaking. And if you fail to do that, if you fail to constantly break and remake your existing conceptual model, you're automatically falling into inertia. And again, this is a axiomatic moment. Keeping blindly to a formula that worked in the past leads automatically to inertia and crisis. And conversely, when things go out of whack, we can see something new and strange, and that is when we learn something. That's it from me for this lecture, for the concept of remaking and synthesis. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter @TedMeetYou. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.